Eucharist, Rite 2 begins in your order of worship, or on page 355 of the Book of Common Prayer. Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins.
His mercy endures forever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Himself and becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, Ye are my son. Today I have begotten you. And he says also in another place, you are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with wild cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverent submission. Though he was a son, he wanted to be obedient to what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for those all who will obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Dark days of waiting, apparently empty tomb on the third day. But we're not there quite yet, and neither is the gospel. Our reading from John today comes from a much larger story that is Jesus' last public teaching. We arrive mid-scene, somewhere within the walls of Jerusalem. Jesus is surrounded by his disciples, the 12 apostles, along with presumably many others, as well as the crowds who have heard of the signs Jesus has performed and have gathered to see and hear for themselves. Among those in the crowd are some whom the gospel identifies as Greeks. They approach Philip, insisting they wish to see Jesus. Philip in turn goes to Andrew, and together they approach Jesus on behalf of these curious guests. Jesus then offers his teaching that in a few lines encompasses much, not only about the days to come, but almost a summary of what Jesus has been teaching his followers throughout his ministry, of the work that he has been doing, as well as a way to think about discipleship, both for these new folks and for those who are already numbered among his followers. He offers a metaphor using the cycle of life, a metaphor about grain that, even if you aren't a gardener, is pretty easy to see. This illustration about grain speaks both of what is to come for Jesus and resurrection, but is also more than that. It's also about what it means to be a disciple. And this encounter also produces a sign, a voice from heaven like thunder, that proclaims God's name has and will be glorified. These unnamed Greeks are, like many who are briefly introduced in the Gospels, a source of curiosity. While the Gospel tells us they have come to worship at the festival of the Passover, it tells us very little else, not even how many of them there were. Yet I think there's a lot to be gleaned from these Greeks who seek Jesus, far more than first meets the eye. These outsiders seem eager to see Jesus. They seem to know who he is and are willing to go to some lengths, a stark contrast to many who question what Jesus is doing, what he's been teaching. So then why do they approach Philip first? Maybe they're simply looking for an introduction, a way to cut through the crowds who are there to listen and gawk but not necessarily engage, or in hopes of a deeper or perhaps more personal conversation. Perhaps they think that Jesus won't speak to them directly, either because they are new to his mission or perhaps because they are Gentiles. Maybe there's a connection in some way to Bethsaida, the gospel seemingly randomly tells us that is Philip's hometown back in Galilee. And maybe Philip isn't so sure either because he goes to his fellow disciple, Andrew, rather than going to Jesus by himself. It's also hard for us to know if Jesus' response is made within hearing of the Greek party. Jesus' words in the gospel are far from clear about who actually receives this teaching. But one thing is certain, Jesus' response does include them as those who would be, if they so choose, become disciples. While discipleship starts with those who Jesus called and those who first followed, it does not end there. And these nameless Greeks are also a sign of something even bigger. Their appearance at this point in the story and the significance of their origin reveals more to us about Jesus. Just before this passage, a critic of Jesus comments in wonder and awe of the crowds, "The whole world has gone after him." These Greeks are an affirmation of that statement, and indeed, Jesus draws all kinds of people. And more importantly, while he had begun at home, his ministry, discipleship, and his saving acts are for all people, those who are from next door, those from the next town, and for everyone, no matter where they are from. A connection back to that famous passage from last week, that God so loved the world, the whole world, indeed all of creation, that he sent his Son, the seed who will fall, die, and yet, paradoxically, produce much fruit, which is also a part of being a disciple. That agrarian metaphor, in the case of being followers, disciples, speaks to a different kind of fruit. The laying down of a life isn't about a literal death, but about living for others, the thing we talk a lot about. But there's something else that speaks to me about Philip and Andrew in this story as well. If you come from or have spent any time with the tradition where there is an expectation or pressure for you to introduce Jesus to others, be it when the need arises or constantly or by some specific formula. That can feel like an incredibly large responsibility, one you may or may not feel equipped or ready to handle then, now, or in the time in between. And even if you haven't, even if you've been in the Episcopal tradition your whole life, that can still feel like a really big ask. We may be at loss as to what to say. We may feel as though we aren't prepared. We may not know what to say when people ask us questions. We may not feel like we have answers. Perhaps that is the hour you would like to be saved from. And while I don't know that I've ever been directly asked to introduce someone to Jesus, I would say I have been asked, more often in roundabout ways, for some reintroductions. That is also a part of discipleship. As Philip and Andrew remind us, that it is a part of the picture, but it's also a helpful reminder that it isn't something we have to shoulder alone. We do not have to go solo. Sometimes introductions, or maybe reintroductions, are best made with help and community with fellow disciples who may not have all of the answers either, but that's okay. Together, we can help point the way to meeting Jesus, to inviting others to discipleship. May we all remember we are a part of a community of disciples who together can bear much fruit. Amen.
Amen.
Turning to page 358 in the Book of Common Prayer, standing as you are able, let us reaffirm our faith with the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was saved again. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people are Form 1, found in your bulletin or on page 383 of the bulletin. With all of our hearts and with all of our minds, let us praise the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the
now and forever.
Amen.
Continuing in your bulletin or turning to page 360, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbors. Most merciful God, we confess we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand as you are able.
Thank you.
command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile Earth, our island home.
By your will, you created and created.
From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord, for we are sinners in your sight.
Again and again, you called us to return. Through prophets and sages, you revealed your righteous law. And in the fullness of time, you sent your only son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood, he reconciles us. By his wounds, we are healed.
And therefore, we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus, with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn. Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving.
We celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming.
For God of our mothers and fathers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God of Sarah, Rebecca, Leah, and Rachel, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world around us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this holy communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name.
Risen Lord, be unto us through bread and bread.
Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit, your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we
God, for the people of God.
Thank you.
Among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.